Good morning. We have general questions. Question one, Jenny Marra.
To ask the Scottish Government what progress it is making on securing decommissioning jobs for Dundee.
Cabinet Secretary John Swinney.
Regarding its £10 million investment in the Port of Dundee, this will put Dundee and the surrounding area in a strong position to maximise the economic and employment benefits that decommissioning and indeed offshore wind can deliver for Scotland. The oil and gas strategy, which was published on the 8th of February, set out how Scotland can play a leading role in the development of a global decommissioning market, while at the same time recognising that all efforts must be taken to avoid premature cessation of production in the North Sea, with the latest industry estimates suggesting around £50 billion will be spent on decommissioning in the North Sea over the next four decades. We must ensure that the decommissioning process is managed effectively and that the Scottish supply chain can capitalise on the value of these projects.
Jenny Marra.
The announcement from Forth Ports was very welcome, as the Cabinet Secretary says, but he will have also noted the comments from Charles Hammond, the Chief Executive, saying that public investment is also needed. To that end, the city deal for Dundee, Cabinet Secretary, the First Minister said to me in response last week that the city deal is under discussion. Can he give me an update on how his discussions are progressing with the UK Government on a city deal for Dundee?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the first part of the answer to that is that when the city deal develops, we will take forward the discussions with the United Kingdom Government, as we do on all of these questions and as we did on, in relation to Glasgow and Aberdeen, and we will continue those discussions as the detail emerges. Of course, that a city deal that emerges will be part of a long-standing series of support that the Scottish Government has given to the City of Dundee through the substantial investment in the V&A, the long-term commitment to the development of the waterfront. Indeed, I was delighted to see the progress update just the other day in media reports of the success of the waterfront developments and the opening up of much of the much transformed infrastructure of the city to the wider public. So the government will maintain strong support to the City of Dundee, as it always has done.
Question number two, Alison McInnes. The question has been withdrawn for understandable reasons. Question number three, Claudia Beamish.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what support it is providing from its International Development Fund to assist with medical and humanitarian aid in Syria.
Minister Hamza Yousaf.
In October 2015, Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government provided £300,000 to support humanitarian assistance to refugees arriving in mainland Europe. The majority of our support went to British Red Cross and Mercy Corps. A contribution was also given to two smaller Scottish-based charities, Edinburgh Direct Aid and Glasgow the Caring City. In January this year, we donated a further £75,000 to support British Red Cross's medical response in Lesbos. In previous years, the Scottish Government has donated £200,000 in 2013 to the Disasters Emergency Committee for humanitarian assistance to those most in need, both within Syria and indeed in refugee camps in the neighbouring area.
Claudia Beamish.
I thank the Minister for that answer and really wanted an update which is valued. However, I wondered the degree to which it's possible to, for the Scottish Government to identify, or whether the Scottish Government has identified, Scottish charities which are able to work in Syria or in the wider Middle East in relation to those people who are civilians who are afflicted within Syria now, and what relations and discussions have gone on with the UK Government in relation to how Scottish Government and UK Government can work together about this.
I mean, I think I really thank the member for bringing this issue to the chamber, because often it can be forgotten with everything else that is going on, and we are in the fifth year of that conflict. 4.6 million Syrian refugees, over 10 million internally displaced as well. So I thank the member for bringing it up. I should say, give credit where credit is due, also to the UK Government. Their response in terms of financial contributions and aid to that region is amongst well, the second best in the world. In terms of identifying Scottish-based charities, there are a number that do come to us with proposals. We haven't had one in recently. I'm always very open-minded. Where we have potential funding to give to help in that area and that region, because it is a disastrous situation, a humanitarian situation, a crisis, which we are more than willing to help. So proposals do come our way. I can promise the member they will be viewed very sympathetically and with an open mind.
Question number four, Gordon MacDonald.
To ask the Scottish Government how many responses it received to its consultation on the comprehensive review of the planning system, which closed on the 1st of December.
Cabinet Secretary Alec Neil.
Sorry, Presiding Officer. The Independent Planning Review Panel received 392 responses to their call for written evidence. All of the responses are available to view online.
Gordon MacDonald.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. One of the contributors to the consultation is the Edinburgh South West Communities Forum, which represents seven community councils in my constituency. They've submitted a detailed 12-page submission that has a number of innovative ideas, from low-cost rate of appeal to statutory compensation to communities from developers. Given the level of interest in this issue, are there any other ways that individuals and communities can engage in the independent review before it reports later this year?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government is currently hosting an online discussion forum on behalf of the independent panel. That will run until the 29th of February, and comments are welcome from any interested parties. This will be used to inform the review panel's thinking, in addition to the formal written and oral evidence. In addition, I understand that the Edinburgh Association of Community Councils is giving oral evidence to the independent panel today.
Thank you. Malcolm Chisholm.
Secretary, aware that literally hundreds of my constituents are appalled at a decision of one Scottish Government reporter against the unanimous view of the Council's Planning Committee to allow the demolition of a much-loved restaurant at Cannon Mills in order for it to be replaced by an unattractive building that blocks a beautiful vista down the water of Leith. Will the Cabinet Secretary do everything possible to reverse that decision? But also, and more generally, does he not think it's time to abolish the developer's right of appeal in circumstances where a Council Planning Committee has been unanimous?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, on the latter point, that's really a matter for a review by the independent review panel. It's those kinds of issues that they are reviewing, and I hope the member will have submitted either written or oral evidence to that effect, if that is what he would like to see happening. As far as the reporter's decision is concerned, it's not possible for me to reverse that decision.
Cameron Buchanan. It's okay.
Thank you.
Question number five, Liam MacArthur.
To ask the Scottish Government when it will next meet Orkney Islands Council and what issues will be discussed.
Minister Mark Baird.
On Monday, I, along with my ministerial colleague Derek Mackay, met the leader and chief executive of Orkney Islands Council as part of the latest Islands Areas Ministerial Working Group meeting. The Minister for Transport and Islands also met representatives of the Council on Tuesday to discuss ferries issues.
Liam MacArthur.
Can I thank the Minister very much for that answer? Presiding Officer, yesterday the Finance Secretary delighted in telling the Chamber that every Council in Scotland had accepted his plan to remove £500 million from their budget. Does the Minister accept that this was only achieved by strong-arming councils with threats of penalties and sanctions, tactics that one senior independent councillor in Orkney described as, quote, reprehensible bully boy tactics? And does he agree with the leader of Orkney Islands Council, Stephen Heddle, that, quote, local government is a separate tier of democracy and should be afforded the respect to carry forward their own decision-making rather than being threatened with a fine of £1.7 million?
Mark Bergey.
I would certainly take the view that it is far better when asking local government to take forward key priorities such as living wage for every social care worker, protecting the council tax freeze, maintaining the pupil-teacher ratio, that we put money on the table to fund that as we have. When we take into account the £250 million, the overall reduction in funding overall for local government is less than 1% of total estimated expenditure. In light of the cuts that have been happening to the Scottish Government's budget since 2010, in part from a coalition government that he supported, I think that has been a very good deal for local government. It is challenging, but it is fair. And in respect of the freezing of the council tax, I do note that during the time of before the freeze, the council tax in the Orkney Islands increased by 116% compared to 62% for the Scottish average, and therefore I think the people of Orkney will probably be welcoming Scottish Government action as well.
Jamie McGregor.
Thank you. What actions has the Scottish Government taken to capitalise on Orkney's successful use of renewable energy, and what steps have been taken to decarbonise the baseload for Orkney?
Mark Beard.
The subject of the interconnector in particular for Orkney to the rest of Scotland to be able to export the renewable energy has been the subject of some debate in the Islands Areas Ministerial Working Group. There are discussions about that vis-a-vis the Islands deal. I have also this week had meetings about building standards with developers in Orkney to discuss how we may be able to respond to calls for a different approach on building standards in Orkney on the basis of the large amount of renewable energy that is being generated. But we are very supportive of the amazing work that has been done in Orkney. It is very much a leader in the field of renewable energy and something that the whole of Scotland should be proud of.
Question number six, David Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government how many Da Vinci surgical systems for the treatment of prostate cancer there are in Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary Suna Robertson.
There is currently one robot to provide robot-assisted surgery for prostate cancer located in Aberdeen Royal Infirmary. The Queen Elizabeth University Hospital in Glasgow is finalising a robot-assisted prostatectomy service, which is expected to be in place by April 2016. A £1 million capital contribution from the Scottish Government has been committed for each robot. NHS Lothian has also been offered £1 million capital to support the introduction of a robot-assisted surgery service in the south-east of Scotland within the next 2 years.
David Stewart.
Presiding Officer, a constituent from Western Isles recently underwent surgery in Aberdeen where the Da Vinci robotic keyhole procedure was used. 3 days after surgery for prostate cancer, he walked 2 miles and he was off painkillers after 4 days. Clearly, this is a transformable effect for patients. What plans does the Cabinet Secretary have to increase the numbers of Da Vinci systems across Scotland to match the coverage in England and Wales?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, first of all, can I say that I'm very pleased to hear about the patient's experience that David Stewart highlighted. Boards are aware of the need to move away from providing open radical prostatectomy and working towards making minimally invasive radical prostatectomy the norm. The West of Scotland boards are developing their plans to introduce a robot around the summer of this year. As I said in my initial answer, NHS Lothian has also been offered £1 million capital to support the introduction of a robot-assisted surgery service in the south-east of Scotland within the next 2 years. So progress is being made and very happy to keep David Stewart updated on that progress.
Question number seven, John Mason.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what analysis it has made of the economic impact in Scotland of the recent flotation of the Clydesdale Bank.
Cabinet Secretary John Swinney.
Presiding Officer, Clydesdale Bank has an established presence in Scotland as a bank servicing personal and business customers and as a substantial employer. We would expect the Clydesdale Bank to continue to have a similar presence in Scotland following the recent flotation of shares on the stock market.
John Mason.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for the reply, and I wonder if he agrees with me that it is important to have independent Scottish companies headquartered in Scotland, as this has a positive impact on the quality of jobs in the wider economy.
Cabinet Secretary.
I agree with John Mason in that respect. It is where we have headquarters functions located within Scotland, it is clear that the knock-on effects in terms of the quality of employment within supporting organisations, within the professional services and with the wider community creates strong opportunities for other organisations within the Scottish market. And obviously it has been particularly significant that Clydesdale Bank has been one of those companies with that strong presence in principally the city of Glasgow, but also the city of Edinburgh. So we look forward to working with Clydesdale Bank, as we always have done, to support the company in ensuring it makes a strong economic contribution to Scotland.
Question number eight, David Torrens.
To ask the Scottish Government how it supports the renewable sector.
Cabinet Secretary John Swinney.
Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government provides a wide range of support for the renewable sector. This includes support for renewables projects and related technology development, a planning system which supports the transition to a low-carbon economy, and strong partnerships with industry, academia and the Scottish agencies, such as through the Renewables Industry Advisory Group.
David Torrens.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Can the Cabinet Secretary provide an update on the Beatrice offshore wind farm and how the tendering process is progressing? The Cabinet Secretary will be aware that BIFAB, based at a Fife Renewable Centre within my constituency, is looking to win a share of our contracts, which is vital to future employment within my constituency.
Cabinet Secretary.
President, officer, the Beatrice Offshore Wind Farm project is a partnership formed between SSE Renewables, Copenhagen Infrastructure Partners and Repsol. The project was consented by Marine Scotland in March 2014 and granted an investment contract by the United Kingdom Government in May 2014. Mr Ewing and officials from the Scottish Government, Scottish Enterprise and Highlands and Islands Enterprise have been working closely with all Scottish offshore wind farm developers to ensure that the Scottish supply chain is used, and that has been the case in relation to the Beatrice project. There has been further dialogue with the company, Scottish and Southern Energy, about the use of the supply chain within Scotland, and they have assured the Scottish Government that they are committed to providing opportunities for Scottish businesses to tender for such activity. It is, of course, essential that the tenders that are returned are competitive to be taken forward. Any contracts awarded from Beatrice would depend on a positive final investment decision that has yet to be taken.
Jenny Marra.
How many of the 750 renewables jobs that the SNP promised to Dundee have been delivered?
Cabinet Secretary.
The issue that we have faced with the renewables industry and the development of the offshore sector has been that the framework within which companies have been developing their propositions has taken longer to materialise, and changes in the United Kingdom government arrangements for these things have made that more challenging. In addition to the fact, it is clear to anyone that is looking dispassionately at this issue that investment by renewables companies has been more challenging to secure and more challenging for those companies to commit to because of the changing environment. So I can assure Jenny Marra, because I know she has questioned the government on this issue before, the whole issue of pursuing jobs in the renewable industry for the city of Dundee has been an absolute priority for the Scottish Government, and it will remain an absolute priority, as does other investment for Dundee, which, as I said in my earlier answer, has been formidable from the Government within the city of Dundee, and I expect further investment to be delivered for the city of Dundee into the bargain.
Question 9, Claire Baker.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to tackle childhood obesity.
Maureen Watt.
This Government is committed to tackling Scotland's issue with obesity through our strategy Preventing Overweight and Obesity in Scotland, a roadmap towards healthy weight. We recognise there is no simple solution and are pursuing actions across a broad front. One that makes it easier for children to be more active, for example, is where we have increased children doing 2 hours or two periods of PE from less than 10% in 2004-05 to 98% in 2015, and to what they eat with our provision of free school meals.
Claire Baker.
I welcome the reply from the Minister, but it is disappointing that Fife and Tayside in particular still have a stubbornly high number of children who are at risk of obesity or are classed as overweight. The Scottish Government Food Commission has expressed support for a specific children's food policy that takes a much more strategic approach towards children's diets. Does the Minister agree that this approach is necessary if we are to achieve long-term cultural change?
Minister.
Yes, I do agree that we need to fund the Child Healthy Weight Intervention Programme. We will continue to fund that programme through the outcomes framework, which will provide greater local flexibility on decisions on how to maximise the value from this resource against clearly defined outcomes, and with a focus on delivering strategic priorities such as reducing health inequalities.
Aileen Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Given that breastfed children are much less likely to present as obese, I wonder, can the Minister give an update on the Government's strategy to support and promote breastfeeding, please?
Minister.
Well, I continue to take a very keen interest in that. In fact, I'm visiting another breastfeeding initiative in the west of Scotland in the next few weeks. We are clearly making progress, but it is very slow progress on persuading more women to start breastfeeding.
Thank you. Before we move to the next item of business, members will wish to join me in the welcome to the gallery, Mr. Atan Na'i, the UK Shadi Affair for Israel. Thank you. We now move to First Minister's questions.